You are watching a video lesson in the lecture series of Botanypedia to help you learn about various concepts of biology. I am Dr. Pawan Kumar, and in this lesson we are going to learn about different methods for measuring correlation. So what is included in this lecture? First, we will have an overview of this topic, followed by the detailed account of three methods that are used for measuring the correlation. So, what are the three methods that we are going to talk about? So, the first method that we will be discussing is about scatter diagram method. Then we will talk about Karl Pearson correlation method. And in the last, we will talk about Spearman rank correlation method. The degree and the strength of the correlation is determined by a correlation coefficient, which is denoted by small letter r. The value of r can be calculated either by Karl Pearson correlation method or Spearman rank correlation method using specific formulae. These formulae are described in subsequent slide. If you want to have an overview of correlation method or an introduction to correlation for estimating relationship between two variables, you can check the description section below for the link to the e-lecture on the topic, Introduction to Correlation. But in this lesson, we will only focus upon methods of measuring correlation. So let's talk about the first method, that is scatter diagram method. First of all, what is a scatter diagram or a scatter plot? So scatter diagram is a graphical way to estimate nature and direction of correlation. When I say direction of correlation, what do I mean by that? Direction means it can be a positive correlation or it can be a negative correlation. So a scatter plot is a kind of a graph that will help us to estimate the nature and direction of the correlation between two variables that we are testing for relationship. The values of both the variables are plotted on x and y respectively. So if you plot the values of variable x, it can be any variable, and variable y, then you may get any of these type of scatter diagrams. So if you just carefully observe the patterns that how these different values are scattered, you will see that in some cases the values are perfectly aligned in a straight line. They are either increasing in a particular fashion or the values of the second variable is decreasing as we are increasing the first variable. So overall there are six diagrams that describe correlation. And if we broadly categorize these six type of scatter diagrams, we can have the first of its type, that is the positive correlation scatter diagram showing negative correlation, zero correlation and curvilinear correlation. Again, the positive correlation scatter plots can be further categorized into two types. If you just look at the first one here, here the two parameters are taken, the age of the tree in years and number of annual rings that are observed, and is also an indication of the age of the tree. So if you see that all the points, all the observations are falling in a perfect line. So this is a type of a perfect positive correlation between the two variables that we are testing. Although in biology it is very rare that we see this kind of a relationship, because in biological systems you will not have a very one-to-one kind of a relationship between two variables that you are testing. Likewise for here, like the perfect negative correlation where all the values, all the points are falling on a particular straight line, this is a very rare phenomena that we see in biology. In partial positive correlation, you will have the trend like they are, with the change in the tail length, there is an increase in the wing length. So there is also a positive correlation, but the values are scattered in a particular way, but they are not exactly falling on a straight line. Likewise, the similar trend, the negative correlation can be a perfect negative correlation as shown in this particular graph, or it can be a partial negative correlation where values are showing a negative trend but they are scattered. But in this graph, particularly here, if you see that the body weight is being correlated with the IQ, and we also know that the IQ has nothing to do with the body weight, if you just think logically. But this can be proven by performing the correlation analysis, where you see that if you plot the observations, you see that all the values are scattered all throughout throughout, so indicating that there is zero correlation. And in this particular, the last sixth type, you see the values are increasing and then they are decreasing. So this is not following a linear relationship, unlike these four, where all the four graphs were put under the linear type of correlation. So it can be a linear correlation or it can be a non-linear correlation. So if it is a non-linear correlation, it can be it is also known as curvilinear correlation. So there are some merits and demerits of using scatter diagram for estimating the correlation value. So if you look at the first point here under merits, we see that the scatter diagrams are simple and easy to demonstrate the linear relationship and non-linear relationship between variables. So without doing much calculation, just by plotting the values in terms of graph, you can predict how the values are related, and you can use this preliminary result to decide further whether you need to perform some other sophisticated test to establish a relationship. So these graphs provide us to decide on to whether the further examination is needed or it is not required. The second merit of using that is the scatter diagram is that the extreme values do not influence the overall results. So if you are getting some values or some dots which are not falling, or which are falling very far away from the line, from the scattered values, and if you plot a curve that describes the scattering of the points, the values of the extreme points will not influence the overall trajectory of the curve. There are some demerits which are associated with the scatter diagrams. Like, for example, it does not provide the exact estimate of the degree of correlation, and for this we need to know the value of correlation coefficient. Like in the previous graphs, I had not shown that what is the value of R, I mean what is the value of correlation coefficient, because the scatter diagrams do not provide this value. So we cannot determine the degree of correlation. Another demerit of using scatter diagram is that it is suitable for small sample sizes, as with large population it becomes cumbersome to plot all values until values are grouped together. Like, for example, you performed experiment on 10,000 individuals and you measured two parameters. You measured their weight, you measured their heights. Now you want to see is there any correlation between the heights and the weights of those 10,000 individuals. So plotting those 10,000 individuals on a scatter diagram will make it look very condensed, or the too much of the cluttering. So it is not suitable if your sample size is big. So that is the demerit of using a scatter diagram. Now we talk about the second method, the most famous, most commonly used method, and it is known as Karl Pearson method for measuring correlation. In biostatistics, you can categorize your variables into two types: quantitative variables and qualitative variables. What are quantitative variables? These are those variables which can be quantitated or expressed or measured in terms of numbers. Like for example, the height, weight, etc. You measure in a particular quantity or in a particular number. So they are numerical in nature. However, on the other hand, you have qualitative data where, like for example, the gender. Gender, it can be a male or it can be a female. So you have only two categories, and you cannot give it a number until you provide a specific coding. So in qualitative data, it is by nature not numerical, and on the other hand, the quantitative data is that kind of a data where the values are expressed in terms of number. So what we are measuring, what we are talking about in this entire lecture is about the small value R. And what is R? That is correlation coefficient. It is the degree of correlation between two parameters that we are testing. So the value of R can vary anywhere between minus 1 to plus 1. So if you are getting a value of R is equal to 0, it simply means that there are two possibilities. First, that there is no correlation, or the correlation is of non-linear type. So if there is a non-linear correlation and no correlation, you are going to get a R value is equal to 0. While on the other hand, if you get plus 1, it means there is perfect correlation, and if it is minus 1, it means that you are having a relationship of perfect negativity. Any value which is falling more than 0.8 is considered very good or strongly correlated, or value which is falling near the 0.5 is considered moderately correlated. So depending upon what value and which part of scale you are, you categorize your type of correlation as positive correlation or negative correlation between the variables that you are testing. So correlation coefficient R is used to measure the strength of the relationship between the two variables. It is determined by the value of R. The sole purpose of calculating the value of R is to determine the strength of correlation. Pearson correlation is the most commonly used method in statistics to determine the strength and direction of a linear relationship between two variables. Values always range between minus 1 indicating strong negative relationship and plus 1 strong positive relationship. Value at or close to 0 imply weak or no relationship. Now we will look at the formula that is used for calculation of Karl Pearson product correlation coefficient, which is denoted by R. So if you look at the formula, you will see there are few terms. First is XI. What is XI? Suppose you measure the heights of 10 human beings. So all the readings of height. So here, what is your first variable X? That is your first variable. So what is XI? XI means all the observations of variable X, in this case height. So if you measure all the value, tabulate them, and then you take the mean of all the 10 observations, that would be your X bar. Likewise, for the same group of 10 individuals, you measure their weight. So what all the observations of the weight would be denoted by YI. And what is Y bar? The mean of all the observations of variable Y. That is, in this case, the weight of 10 individuals. Now you subtract the mean from their individual value and you get the mean deviation. And when you square the mean deviation and you square it and you get these products, so These are some terms that you have got from the values that you have obtained by noting down the specific observations. Why and how these values are important for calculation, for in order to understand what roles variance and covariances have in determining the value of R, you can refer to the e-lecture. Link for that is provided in the section below. So here in this equation, xi and yi are the individual values of observations of variable x and y. X bar and y bar are the means of two variables x and y respectively. So if you want to simplify this formula, this entire term that you see here in the bracket can be simplified to dx, and this term can be simplified to dy. Likewise, if you replace this formula becomes summation of dx multiply dy divided by the square root of semi product of summation of dx square multiply by summation of dy square. You know, in my subsequent slide, we will see that how these terms are calculated, or the numerator and denominators are calculated in order to get the final value of R. So from the formula, we can see that the numerator and the denominator contain terms that can be related to covariance and variance respectively. So if you are interested in understanding the role of variance and covariance in determining the degree of correlation, you can check the e-lecture entitled Introduction to Correlation, for which the link is provided in the description section. So this is question number one that is used here as an example to calculate or compute the Karl-Pearson product correlation coefficient. So an experiment was performed to determine the correlation between the lamina area and the petiole length of leaves of Ficus religiosa, which is known as peepal tree, observations, that is observations on lamina area and observations on petiole length, of these two variables were measured for 9 randomly selected leaves. So it is important to note that the observations that you are selecting, it should be randomly selected. It shouldn't be that you are biased about selection and you by choice you pick up certain individuals which will show some kind of observation or the values. So it should be randomly selected. And the readings were recorded and tabulated. Now the question here is to calculate the correlation coefficient R from the provided data set, and in the last we will see and interpret our results. So this is a typical picture of a peepal tree, and this is the question, and this particular leaf blade is known as lamina, and this is a petiole. This is just a one representative picture. So 9 of such leaves were randomly plucked and their values were measured. So using the graph paper, the area of this particular leaf was plotted on graph paper by a group of students at undergraduate course taking biostatistics as a subject, and they recorded the values in the centimeter square, and the petiole length was measured in centimeters, and these were the values. So the question is there any correlation between the lamina area and the petiole length? So to answer this question, let's look at the solution. So this is the way that we calculate this is how we tabulate the data to compute this particular correlation coefficient. So you write your all the leaf numbers here from 1 through 9, and their lamina area, which is plotted. So the value of the x is given, the value of y is given. So the pink colored boxes correspond to lamina area, all the terms that are associated with lamina area, and the blue colored boxes are for petiole length. So if you just see, these are the values from the question, and if you see this, these are the values from the question for y. So how to take the mean? So you add all these observations and you divide by the total number of observations, that is 9. So you add these and divide it by 9, so you will get 75.09. I am purposely writing this value again and again in a separate column. Why? Because it helps us to compute this term called dx. What is dx? Each value, which is xi, this one, the 84, will be subtracted. Mean value will be subtracted from 84. So 84 minus 75 will give us this value. Likewise, we will subtract xi 75.06, that is mean, from this value. So we keep subtracting these values, and we keep getting this value. So there will be some values which are positive, obviously, because the lamina area is going to be larger than the mean value, and there are some values which are smaller than the mean value, so we will get some of the values as negative values. So this column, or the values which are represented in this column, they are referred to as dx. Now, to get rid of the negative sign, we square these observations. So if you square these observations, you are going to get the d square. And same thing you do with the observations of on PTO length, and you have the mean that you get by adding all these observations and dividing it by 9, and then you subtract the value of yi with the mean, and you get these values, and then you square the observations, and then comes the most important step, because if you remember the formula, so these are the terms that we are interested in. So I have highlighted the terms that are required in the formula as yellow boxes. So what is this? The total of all of this. So this is going to be summation of dx, which is 3201.22. So we add these observations. So this term in the last, in the bottom part of this column, is known as summation of dx square, this term. Likewise, you have summation of dy square, which is in the numerator. And then there is another column that is obtained by multiplying the value of dx, which is 8.94, by the value of dy, this column. So you multiply 8.94 with 2.17 and you get this value. Then you keep doing this for other values, and you add them up. Here the signs are important, so if it is negative, keep it negative, if it is positive, keep it positive. Then you add this value. So this is your summation of dxy. So one of the errors that students usually do when they are computing the R is that they take the summation of dx and they take the summation of dy, and then they multiply it. So this results into an error. So kindly note that you have to first multiply the value of dx with dy one by one to create a separate column, and then you add the value and you use this value directly in the formula. So this entire numerator is your this term, which is 199.33, and the dx square and dy square is your these are the values. You solve this and you will get a value of R is equal to 0.801. So this is what we wanted to do this entire calculation for. What is the interpretation of this particular experiment? So the value of correlation coefficient, which is R is equal to 0.801, shows a strong positive correlation, because if you remember from the slide where I showed you a scale, and I mentioned that any value which is greater than the 0.8 on that scale indicate a strong positive relationship. So it result shows there is a strong positive correlation between the lamina area and the PTO length. It means that if you keep on increasing the PTO length, you expect a positive increase in the lamina area of the leaves. However, there are some other tests, statistical tests of significance, that are used to further test this hypothesis, whether this relationship that we are getting, that is a positive relationship, is really significant or insignificant. But that is beyond the scope of this particular lecture, so it is not discussed here. So again, there are some merits and demerits of Carl Pearson method. So let's look at the merit first. This method gives us an exact estimate of degree of correlation, because we are getting the exact value of R. That's why it is giving us the exact estimate. It also tells us about the direction of correlation, because if the value is positive, it is positively correlated, and if it's negative, it is negatively correlated. There are demerits also. It is extremely affected by the extreme values, and answer to that lies in, if you look at the formula, we are calculating the mean deviation of each observation. Suppose out of 10 observation or 9 observation, one observation is very, very, very far away from the mean value, it will affect the result, because the difference of that would be larger. So overall value of R will get affected. So if you are including outliers in your observations or extreme values, it is definitely going to affect the value of R. It assumes linear relationship between variables, but in real life, especially if you are a biology student, the variables do not follow linearity in strict terms. There are deviations from that. So it is not always going to give you a true picture as what is actually happening in nature. It is only suitable for quantitative variables. Suppose if you want to find the correlation between any qualitative variable, between qualitative variables, then you cannot use this method. So now we talk about our third type or method for estimating correlation. That is called Spearman's rank method for correlation. As I already mentioned that it is specifically used for measuring the correlation between qualitative variables. So this method is used in those cases where quantitative measurements are not possible. In other words, we can say that it is suitable for qualitative variables such as intelligence, color of a flower or a color of any object, ranks, or honesty, etc. So these are the things which you cannot measure in exact numbers. So you have to give a specific coding or serial number to the different levels of hierarchy to define it properly, and then you can perform a correlation analysis. This kind of a test was for the first time developed by Charles Edward Spearman, and you can also see his name appearing in the name of the method, in 1904. And this method is also known as concurrent deviation method. So what happens in this method, and why we do so, and what is the benefit of doing this analysis? So what are the different ways to do it? What are the different steps that are involved? We will be discussing about those steps in the subsequent slides. But to summarize, there are three points which are listed here. So the different levels of a variables are arranged in the order of their preference, known as ranks. Like somebody is scored some marks and you give them rank based upon who scored highest gets the rank first, like we usually do in schools or colleges or in any exam. These ranks are based upon some preferences that are very well defined. For example, during a college admission process in a particular course such as BSc Honours in Botany, students can be assigned different ranks or preferences, we can say, based upon if they had mathematics as an additional subject along with biology in the qualifying exam. Usually in botany, we look at whether the students had qualified in biology at their class 12th level. But we can add extra requirement, like for having maths, because having maths also adds to the reasoning or analytical ability of students in solving biological problems. So we can definitely choose this as another criteria for taking admission. So if you get a list of students, you see that how many of them they got both the subjects are given more priority than the others. So you define the data set in a particular way that you give them some ranks and you proceed from there onwards. So how you proceed from there onwards will be explained in next slides. So computation of the Spearman's rank correlation method. So here there are three different situations. Like first, the actual ranks are known. So you will have a data set where ranks are already defined. So you have to take it from there. You have to apply the formula and get the value of R and conclude based upon that. But sometimes ranks are not given, numbers are available, and those numbers needs to be arranged in ascending and descending order, and then it is followed by assigning them each value a particular rank. And once the ranks are assigned, we take it from there as we proceeded in case of the first situation. In the third one, what happens that the ranks are not given, so we give them rank. After ranking each observation, we find that some of the values, for some of the values there was a tie. Like out of a marks list, if two students scored exact the same marks, then both of them will stand at same rank. So how to deal with that kind of a situation is taken into account by considering this situation. So the value of, again, the R can also vary from -1 to +1, as it was in case of Carl Pearson correlation method. And there is a formula that is used here, and which is different from the formula that was used in case of Carl Pearson method for calculating correlation coefficient. So if you just look at this D square, what this represents, it represents the difference between the pair of same individual in two corresponding ranks. It will become more clearer in the subsequent slide when we practice the numerical. What is N? Remember, N is not the total number of observations. N here represents how many numbers of pairs of observations. So here the pairs of observations we are looking at. And what is RS? Obviously, it represents the Spearman's rank correlation coefficient. So to differentiate it from Carl Pearson correlation coefficient, we put a subscript of S. S represents Spearman's. So there is a question on for computation of Spearman's rank correlation method. The first case when the actual ranks are known. So 8 individuals were assigned ranks on the basis of their performance by 2 judges in an inter-college storytelling competition organized during a college festival. Calculate the coefficient of rank correlation. Like, you know, in the colleges there are always some sort of activities keep on happening, and for judging a particular activity where 8 students have performed, 2 judges were assigned, and they ranked the students based upon certain rules and they assigned them some ranking. Now we want to see, is there any correlation between the results that is being declared by judge A and judge B, and is it really a fair, the result that we are getting is really concordant with both the judges? And if it is concordant with both the judges, can we really rely upon that? So these are sort of questions that we get the answers when we perform this test. So if you look at the this particular example, like from the previous question, these are the number of name of the students, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. These are not serial numbers. These are the names of students, suppose. And these are the ranks like given. Like the first student got the first rank. Second student got the 8th rank. Third student got 2nd rank. Fourth got 5th rank, and so on and so forth. Similarly, the judge B gave ranks to all these students. The first step is that we calculate the differences in their ranks. So remember that you cannot change the position of these individuals when you are making a table. This is the most important precaution that you have to keep in mind while calculating this correlation, type of correlation. So do not change the position of observations. Keep them as it is. And then put their ranks. Here the ranks are already given. So you calculate their difference, that you subtract this value from this value and you get this value. To get rid of the effects of these negative signs, we square this particular term and we get the value of d square. So now I think it is clear what d square represents. So it represents the difference of ranks for a particular individual that is given by the two judges here in this example. So what is the number of rank pairs? So if you see, there are 8 students and all the observations are complete. So there are 8, obviously there are 8 rank pairs. So you have this formula that was shown in the previous slide. You just have to put the substitute the values. So 6. So put the value of summation of d square, which is 8, and the value of n, and solve this. You solve this, you get a value of 0.904. Now you are already aware that if a value which is very close to 1 has a very, very strong correlation. So we have R of S is equal to 0.904. This indicates a strong positive relationship between the ranks of each student given by both the judges A and B. Meaning that if somebody has really got first position in a competition, his position is justified. Why? Because this value is very high and both the judges, the results which are based upon this particular statistical method can be strongly supported. So this is a kind of a test you can perform in your college to challenge or a particular judgment that you think is not right. So you have as many as judges possible, mostly a dais of judges having 3 judges is considered good, because in that case we have more number of columns or the categories, so we can always compare. But that is beyond the scope of this lecture. Here in this lecture we are only looking at two columns here, so R1 and R2. We are comparing based upon that. So this indicates strong positive difference. This also suggests that the students were fairly judged based upon the criteria specified during the selection process. Now we talk about the second case where the RS is calculated when the ranks are not known. So calculate the Spearman's rank correlation coefficient for marks obtained by a group of 8 students in 2 subjects. That is biostatistics and analytical techniques in plant sciences. Interpret your answer. So the test was taken. 8 students' marks were recorded. X refers to biostatistics paper. Y refers to analytical techniques in plant sciences paper. And these are their marks. And if you note these marks, you see that none of the values are repeated. So there is no tie in any of the papers. Because why I am mentioning this here? Because in the case 3, you will see that suppose some student is getting 23 and there is another student who is also getting 23, then the ranks will be calculated in a particular way. That we will discuss in case 3. So how to calculate the Spearman ranks correlation here? So this is the solution. So this is the first column shows the values of X, the scores of biostatistic paper. Then first thing is that we have to assign them ranks because the ranks are not given. So if we assign them ranks, we can proceed as we had proceeded in the previous case, that is case 1. So how to assign the rank? So look at these marks carefully and see which is the highest. So from the observation, you see the highest lies at 50. So you assign that score number 1. So this is rank 1. Likewise, you see that it is followed by 46, the second highest. Then you assign it rank 2. Likewise, you assign rank 3, rank 4, rank 5, rank 6, rank 7, and rank 8. So this is how you decide the ranking of these scores. Now you have another variable Y, the scores in analytical techniques in plant sciences paper, and you have these marks. You proceed exactly in the same way and calculate their rank. So 49 was the highest, followed by 42, 41, then 4th rank, 5th rank, 6th rank, 7th rank, and 8th rank. Now you have the values of R1 and R2 like you had in the previous case. So you can just simply subtract the value. You calculate the square of that value and you take the summation of the D square. And you apply the same formula, and after applying the same formula, you get a value of 0.595. So this is nearly close to 0.6. So any value which is greater than 0.5 shows a fairly good kind of correlation. So hence we have RS value is equal to 0.595. This indicates a fairly good positive correlation. That is, higher a student ranked in biostatistics, the higher he or she ranked in analytical techniques in plant sciences, or vice versa. So here you can test that the performance of the student was strongly correlated or fairly correlated in both the subjects. Now we will compute Spearman rank correlation using case 3, in case 3 where the ranks are equal. So these are some 7 steps or 7 points that you have to keep in mind when you are doing this kind of calculation. So let's read these points one by one. So when two or more than two values within a series, when I say within a series, it means that, like for in the previous example, the marks in the biostatistics paper. So if you are looking in the marks of the biostatistics paper for the 8 students, then if we find if the both values are equal, if some two values are equal, then what to do with the ranking, how to assign them ranks. So when two and more than two values within a series are equal, then both the values should have the same rank. It is very straightforward to understand this. So for example, if we did two students scored 48 as the highest marks in a test, then both of them will have a rank 1. That is same rank or equal rank. So in case we assign each score a common rank, in this case what we will do, we will give them a common rank. So we will not call them rank 1, but we will give them a common rank. In this case, if we are taking an example of rank 1, but suppose if you are looking at rank 5 and there are two students, both of them they represent rank 5, then how to proceed with the calculation? So what is common rank? Common rank is the average of ranks that each item would have had if these were slightly different from each other. For example, if the scores are ranked equal at 6th rank due to their equality, and if they had differed slightly, then their ranks would have been 6th and 7th. Right? So both the values look same, but if you arrange them in from in descending order, the 6th value of the 6th student and the 7th student, the 6th or the 7th rank student, they will lie next to each other. So what we do, we take the average of the ranks, not the scores, remember that, average of their ranks. And if we do take the average of 6th and 7th rank, it will come up, it will become 6.5. So we will not say that this is the 6th student because it appears at serial number 6, or it is the 7th rank holder because it appears at the 7th. So what we will say, both the students have a rank of 6.5. So this is how we assign them a common rank. Likewise, if 3 scores are equal, common rank is assigned to each by taking the average of these 3 consecutive ranks. like if there were like three students, 6th, 7th and 8th ranks having same marks, what we will do, we will take the average of 6th, 7th and 8th rank, and the answer that we will get will be the rank of each individual. So overall value of RS is further adjusted by adding the term 1 by 12 m cube minus m in brackets to summation of d square in the numerator of the formula. If you just look at this formula, you will see that the everything is same except that this entire term, which is 1 by 12 bracket in within brackets m1 cube minus m1 has been added. So this is called correction term. Why we are using this correction term? Because of the repetition of the scores and the because of the common rank that we are incorporating. So, and why these terms are repeated twice? If there are two observations which are exactly identical or same, then we repeat these two terms by the particular value. So if in this question, if you see that there are two, it has been repeated two times. Why it has been repeated two times? Because if you take a question where two values are repeated, you repeat this correction term twice. So this will become very clear in the subsequent question. And here in this formula, M refers to number of items repeated with the same rank. So computation of a Spearman's rank correlation, case 3. When ranks are equal. So we will calculate the RS for marks obtained by a group of 8 students in two subjects, X and Y. It is the same question that appeared in case 2, but the observations are different. To highlight which observations are different, I have highlighted the marks in yellow boxes. So you can see there are two students who got 50 out of 50, and there are two students who got 42 out of 50 in subjects X and Y respectively. So their ranks would be same. So for this kind of a situation, we will use this method. So this is the solution of that problem. So how to go about it? So you list the observations in column X, and then you assign them ranks. So how to assign them ranks? The highest, the first rank, and the second one, the first two students. So if you add one, and the second, so if you make a list of these values in a descending order, this value will appear at serial number 1 and this value will appear at serial number 2. So the first and the second term in that descending list, so you add these two lists and you take the average of these two terms. So if you take the average of these two, so 1 plus 2 is 3 and divided by 2 gives you 1.5. So you will not say this is first term and this is second term. You will say this is 1.5th term and the second rank is this is 1.5th rank. So it's having, they are the topper, but they are actually having 1.5th rank and 1.5th rank. So their ranks are equal, but they are described in a different way. Again, so now the most important thing. You will not, because the two entries are already taken into account. So whosoever is scoring lower than that will get the third position in the list of the descending order. So this is the third rank. So where is the second rank, right? So this is the important observation that you have to keep in mind. So then you have the fourth rank, fifth rank, sixth rank, seventh rank and eighth rank. Likewise, you do for Y. And you calculate the value of R2. Here, what is the highest value? 49. Then it is followed by this term and this term. So it will be the second term and then the third terms. You take the average of second and third. So 2 plus 3 is 5 divided by 2 is 2.5. So you assigned other values. So this term and this term highlighted in green will have same rank as 2.5, and others will have rank according to their position. Now, once you have the value of R1 and R2, you proceed exactly in the same way you proceeded in case 1 and case 2. But only difference is that here, since only the values are getting repeated twice, so you repeat this correction term twice. So you put the values. So what is the value of D square, summation of D square here is 33. What is the value of M? What do you mean by M? So if you remember, how many values are getting repeated and how many times? So that is your M, 2 times. And why 2 correction terms? Because it is happening twice. And you solve this, you get the values. So if you carefully note that even with the changes, in a slight changes in the values of repetition here, the result is same. So for this particular data, the result is coming out to be same. So we arrive at the same kind of conclusion that the data shows that it has fairly good positive relationship or correlation. That is, higher a student ranked in biostatistics, the higher he or she ranked in analytical techniques in plant sciences, and vice versa. So there are also some merits and demerits which are associated with Spearman's rank correlation method, right? For merits, let's look at the first point. It is easy and simple to understand and apply. The formula is very simple. It's ideal for presenting qualitative data. It cannot be used in case of grouped frequency distribution data. So this is one of its demerits. And the second demerit is same as that of the demerit of the Karl Pearson rank correlation method, that it is suitable for only small sample sizes, as with large populations it becomes cumbersome to calculate. So these are the suggested reading. These are the three books. You can read the chapters on correlation and the methods of estimating correlation. So if you really like this lesson and you think that it is helping you in any way, you can like, subscribe and share this e-lecture. If you want to get added to the subscription list, you can subscribe our mailing list at the website, that is www.botanypedia.com. If you want to get a PDF of this presentation, you can text in the comment section below, or alternatively, you can visit the website. I thank you once again for watching.